I'm Ruth Badger, and in business, I've got the golden touch. You may have seen me on TV before, but this time, I'm in charge.
I've got 13 years business experience.
In 2 years, I helped a company increase the turnover from 3.1 million to 13.1. That's 10 million in 2 years. Struggling businesses, no matter how big or small, I'll make it my business to turn you around. So if your company's on its knees, I'm the person to call. Bring on the Badger.
This week, I'll be taking on three warring salesmen.
I'm not going to ignore a customer just because you happen to have said hello to them first,
No, I didn't ask you to. I just said that's how I sometimes see it.
Who need to shape up or ship out.
Your attitude absolutely stinks.
Fucking buck up or get out, because I'm not going to fucking tolerate it.
Sales mastermind Ruth Badger has been called to rural Norfolk to help salvage the fortunes of caravan and motorhome dealership Greentrees Adventure Store. With nearly 200 caravans and motorhomes sitting in the yard, that's £1 million worth of stock, this business is under enormous pressure to sell, sell, sell.
You're getting there? It's a bit of a tight squeeze, I know.
And with the stock on loan and interest mounting unless he shifts quickly, MD Neil is feeling the strain.
I'm always acutely aware of if we don't keep our eye on the ball, the business can slide just like that.
To make matters worse, competition is fierce with 30 other dealers in the local area. But despite Neil's desperation to maintain his position in the marketplace, his salesmen aren't quite so focused.
Bollocks.
There used to be a door here, but it seems to be missing now, so I don't quite know what's happened to that.
Rather than concentrating on selling, most of their time is spent bitching and backstabbing.
A very happy customer is now on his way out of the door because he dealt with me and not the rat in the corner.
Sales technique number one. Get some of your own business cards and you actually plant them in Mark's business cards. So next time he gives his card out to a customer, he actually gives one of my cards instead of his.
It may be fun and games on the shop floor, but MD Neil isn't laughing.
When we get it right, they go silky smooth. But when things don't, unfortunately, they go drastically wrong.
As the market closes in around them, the Badger has just 7 days to increase sales and sort out these squabbling salesmen. But her expectations of them couldn't be further from the truth.
I think I'm going to walk into a very, very friendly sales environment. Middle-aged men who go caravanning every single weekend. So it's going to be interesting to see how they like selling Badger style.
I know a girl with a golden touch. She's got enough, she's got too much.
Morning.
Morning.
But I know you wouldn't mind. You could have it all if you wanted. You could have it all if it mattered so much.
Morning. Neil?
Hello, yes.
Hello, pleased to meet you. I'm Ruth Badger, how are you?
How are you? I'm very well.
Ah, so I thought I was coming into motorhomes and caravans and I'm standing in a surf shop.
Yep, this is our latest business. It's what we've just taken on. But this is not the priority. You know, what you're going to be looking at is our caravan motorhome concerning.
So tell me exactly why I'm here, because you're not wasting my time, are you? There is a business need here.
I see there's a business need here.
Right, so what is it?
2 years ago, the business was very busy, extremely busy. And when you're busy, you become less disciplined. I think we need to sharpen up our professionalism on our sales side.
Do you know what motivates your staff?
Money and enjoyment of the job.
How much is their OTE?
Their what?
On target earnings?
You're asking me a question which Paul should know.
You should know that surely, because you hold all the purse strings.
No, I'm not an accountant.
How have you been doing this month?
I knew you'd ask me that.
Yeah.
I ain't got a clue. You're asking me questions you should be asking Paul.
No, you're the owner of the business. You should know every single thing that's going on.
No, I shouldn't. No,
absolutely,
I disagree with that. No, I don't.
I'll tell you the difference is,
go on.
You should have a snapshot of what's happening in your business.
Not every
if
day.
Not, yeah, but by week. What day is it today?
Tuesday.
It's Monday.
It's Monday. God. Right, I work weekends.
It's Monday, okay? So you should have a snapshot of what happened in last week.
With Neil unclear about the exact sales figures, or even what day of the week it is, Ruth's hoping his sales manager, Paul, has got his finger on the pulse.
How are you? Right.
I'm well, thanks.
Good, good. What are the targets this month?
This month is 13 each.
And where's Vern against his target?
Vern at the moment did...
You don't know?
No, I don't know off the top of my head, no. I have just had a weekend off.
Oh, excuse me.
No.
Paul, I do apologise that I've come in on this Monday wanting to know information.
Yeah.
If I'd been here and this is next week or the week after,
no,
this pink book would be coming towards your head in a very harsh manner.
Wouldn't have known either.
Right, well, you will. I guarantee you that.
Right, okay.
Do you train them?
Don't sit down and train them.
No.
Speak to them about certain things where they should perhaps try and build more rapport, whether they should perhaps... ask more questions.
How do you monitor whether they do that or not?
We don't.
I was really shocked that Paul didn't seem to know what was happening in his sales department day by day. Neil gave the excuse of, I'm not in it. Paul had no excuse.
Unimpressed with the two bosses, the Badger tracks down two of the three salesmen. Matt Dack.
Ruth Badger,
how are you?
Dave.
Yeah, I'm all right.
You all right?
Hungover, but okay.
And Mark Jordan.
All right, not bad.
You all right?
Yes, thank you.
I'm just going to sit down for a bit. So what time do you actually start?
I started at 9, but I was here about 9:15, maybe.
It's a good job I'm not your manager, innit? Yeah, believe me, Matt, you wouldn't be laughing then.
So you say I'm going to have a job with you and my manager then, Ruth?
No, I'm saying then if you come at 9:15 and thought it was funny, you'd get my foot up your backside quicker than
would
you
would. Would I really?
I'm not joking.
Well, you're a harsh manager.
No, I'm not. I'm a very good manager, but my staff are very, very efficient. So how many did you actually sell last week?
I have to check the profit book, but I think 5.
What do you think? You know how many you sold, surely?
I've got a hangover.
Well, I'm not interested in that, to be completely honest. Met Matt for the first time, and to say I'm shocked here is an understatement.
I don't think she liked me at all.
He thinks it's funny to come into a work with a hangover. Do you know what? I've gone to work with a hangover, but I don't think it's funny.
I love winding people up. And, she's just opened herself up to be a prime target. I can't wait. This is going to be a good week. I can't wait.
Having met cocky Matt, now Ruth meets his older brother Vern and Vern's arch rival, Mark.
Who do you decide who sees what customer?
You don't.
It's free for all.
Speaks first.
So do you ever normally have a punch up here?
No, but I find it quite offensive when I had never actually told you this, so it's quite interesting.
Good,
but when a customer walks in and I say, hi, how you doing, good morning, and try and speak to them, then Vern will do exactly the same to introduce yourself and obviously enforce your presence, which is fine, but I find that quite rude.
I'm not going to ignore a customer just because you happen to have said hello to them first, no.
No, I didn't ask you to, I just said that's how I sometimes see it.
Fair enough.
All I did was ask one simple question, which is what happens to a customer when they walk through the doors? And they were hissing at each other like cats. As much as it's entertaining for me to watch, it's actually a really big problem for this business. Because what you've got is three competitive men in an environment with no management.
Shocked by the salesman's childish behaviour, the Badger decides it's time to get serious. She wants to test them on their sales technique by getting them to sell to her. First up, it's Matt. But despite Ruth telling him she has a budget of $12,000, straight away he undersells.
Obviously brand new, the right side of £10,000.
And so does Vern.
About £9,500 plus delivery, so just under 10.
Mark avoids the subject of money, but his monotone delivery is not engaging Ruth.
Now if you're looking at something like a Swift Charisma, your microwave is £115 optional extra, and your CD player is £140 extra as well.
Matt is somewhat more animated, but rather than demonstrate the facilities, he points to them and tries to impress Ruth with his technical jargon.
You've got a mini Hecky roof light there. You do not get that in the Bowley Ranger. You've got one at the back as well.
After pushing Vern for the vital facts, Ruth tests his ability to close by giving a clear buying signal.
I mean, it's good. It's a nice caravan.
Uh-huh.
Very nice.
Good.
Yeah.
Glad you like it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
So would you like to talk any more about it? Would you like to see anything else?
Thank God you started to close, because I thought Christmas was going to come quicker.
Once everyone has had their turn, the Badger is worried she has her work cut out.
The thing that disappointed me the most is the most confident, outgoing, bubbly people in the business, don't show it when they're sales. So Matt and Vern really lack the personality. At least Mark sits up the corner and he's quiet all the time.
Concerned the boy's poor technique could be down to the sales manager, Ruth puts Paul to the test as well. But unlike his team, he takes the time to find out what her needs are.
What are you going to use the caravan for? Who's going to use it?
Me and my partner, and we'll probably take my nephew, possibly my parents away.
Once inside, Paul wastes no time in highlighting the features.
You have a swivel head toilet. It's not huge, but it does give you room to move all around.
Mm-hmm.
And you have spotlights underneath here too, so.
Okay.
You know, just for different lighting areas, gives you two living areas.
Mm.
Sometimes more of an issue with your nephew.
Mm.
Kids sometimes like to be a little further away.
Where'd I don't
know where the PlayStations, just in general.
And when it comes to closing the deal, Paul confidently leads the conversation.
Is it something you've come through today just to have a look around and just perhaps discuss? Is it something you're looking at perhaps
depends how good you are on what deal you can do for me.
Okay. Well, in that case, we'd need to go indoors, sit down, take some of your details.
The good news is the fact that Paul can sell, thank God. The weird thing is that everybody else can't sell as well as him, and he's not actually training or demonstrating his ability.
It's day two, and after the boys' poor performance in the sales task the day before, Ruth wants to expose what really goes on when the salesmen think no one is watching. She's got some secret filming, and her and the bosses watch the revealing footage for the first time.
I'm going to give you what I wish could happen in my business every single day. Whenever the boss is away, the staff play. So I'm going to show you undercover filming of what happens in your business with your staff.
The mystery shopper has been briefed to show interest in a particular caravan. The first salesman she meets is Monotone Mark.
Hello there.
Hello. Are the ones out the front, are they all already sold?
Or? Yes, they're all customers'
vans. Right, let me tell you what, the biggest thing about that. She walks in, straight away Mark greets her. Fantastic. He sits in his chair and continues to talk to her while she's standing. That is a real body language issue.
Really did take one eye.
Too
off. Doesn't smile very much, does he? It doesn't look a face that I'd be happy and looking forward to doing business with.
Would you get finance on one like that?
You certainly would, yeah.
I'd say she's pissed him off. Look at his face.
He's normally sort of with cuffs.
Clinical Mark's disinterested body language and lazy sales technique has angered his bosses and Ruth. But there's worse to come when he tells the customer a blatant lie.
Have you got a car?
Oh, I'll just grab you one. There you go.
And you are?
Simon.
Simon.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks very much.
Thanks for your time. Enjoy your evening.
Hang on, what did you just say?
He's got a blank card. She's asked him his name. He's written Simon.
That is...
Yeah.
Unforgivable.
Yeah, there's no excuse.
There's no excuse other than when she walks back in, I don't want to deal with her.
If I was Mr. Customer and I went back in there and found out that his name indeed wasn't Mark and was Simon, that would be the end of dealing with this company.
Of course
it
would.
Bang, you'd be out of that door.
After confronting Neil and Paul with the damning footage, it's Mark's turn to face the music. Ruth starts by addressing his body language.
You sat down.
Yep.
It's rude.
Is it?
Very. Are you conscious that you do that?
I do it on purpose, to be
Why?
Honest. I thought it was a plus side. I thought it was kind of relaxed and inviting.
You've got barriers all the way around you, but you as a salesman can't have that, and that's the sitting down. That's where you sit down.
Having highlighted Mark's physical faults, Ruth cuts to the chase.
What do you think is the one thing that I would never, ever do? Simon.
Simon?
Yeah.
Simon, sorry, I don't understand. I know
that. Oh, look at that spark!
I gave her a false name.
Why did you do that?
I'd done that because I knew that she was, 90% sure that she was just a mystery shopper asking silly questions to try and trip me up. So.
I think that's rubbish, and I think you did it because she was a pain in the arse, that if she come back in, there is no way you wanted to deal with her again, which is why you keep blank business cards round the corner away from your desk.
Yeah.
Am I right or am I wrong?
You are 100% right.
Right.
Mark may have confessed to the badger, but now he has to face his bosses.
Can you appreciate if that was a genuine customer and came back and found out, in fact, you'd put a false name into her?
that would be the end for the company.
Not something I've ever done before, and not something that I ever likely to do it again. Even to a very...
No, I know!
Very, yeah. Even to a very minging girl in the nightclub, just in case.
Coming up, it's Vern's turn to face the Badger, and he's in trouble.
It's a good job that this isn't called Ruth Badger's Motorhomes, because you'd have been 45.
Ruth lays down the law.
You three are lazy salesmen.
And things get serious when salesman Matt is hauled before the boss.
Fucking buck up or get out, because I'm not going to fucking tolerate it.
Greentrees caravan dealership is under pressure. With the market depressed and 30 local competitors all fighting for business, MD Neil is desperate for help.
When we get it right, they go silky smooth. But when things don't, unfortunately, they go drastically wrong.
But it's not just his rivals Neil's worried about. It's his own squabbling salesman letting the side down.
I'm not going to ignore a customer just because you happen to have said hello to them first. No,
no, I didn't ask you to. I just said that's how I sometimes say it.
Fair enough.
Sales expert Ruth Badger has just 6 days left to call a truce and rescue Greentrees from sliding into chaos.
You get my foot up your backside quicker than
would
you
I really?
I'm not joking.
She's going to sort me out.
Yeah, whatever.
It's the Badger's second day at Greentrees, and after spending the morning watching damning footage of salesman Mark, Ruth has more in store for bosses Neil and Paul. But they're about to find out that she saved the worst till last. After looking around on her own, the second mystery shopper hasn't been approached by anyone for a shocking 25 minutes. Finally, back inside, a salesman makes an appearance, and it's Vern who's first on the scene.
Sorry, are you looking for some help?
Yeah, I've had a look round. There are a couple out there.
Okay, have you been out and had a look in?
The worst thing is, he said go out and have a look, and she said I've just been out there, and there's two I like.
She did, yes.
Once again, after being sent out by Vern, for the second time, the customer looks around for a further 10 minutes.
Oh, hi, again. You alright?
Oh, hello, yeah.
How'd you get on?
It's got a sort of pinkish interior.
It's not the one just out of this window here, is it?
To point through a window. On something that's going to cost her, what, 1,500? 15 grand?
Yeah.
Why isn't he taking her out and going, there's your fridge, there's your cooker?
I'd love to give you an answer.
As with salesman Mark, Vern continues to sell from the comfort of his sales desk.
Yeah. The fridge will work on both, and the heating in there, I think, is both.
Show around the fucking valley.
You can make the bed up at the back and into a double.
It's a double, isn't it?
It is.
Take a fucking ounce!
God!
After enduring half an hour of Vern selling through the window and having been on the premises now for over an hour, the customer is first to raise the subject of money.
The price at the minute is a bit out of my budget.
I mean, what is your... Or is it...
God!
Yeah.
Stumbled over a clothes.
It's a bit like 10.
He's afraid of the clothes.
His technique was fucking shocking. That conversation took no thread at all. At all. So he might as well be talking to his fucking pet cat. Which he hasn't got.
Whilst Neil and Paul are left fuming, Ruth wastes no time in getting Vern's reaction to the shocking footage. She starts by confronting him with his reluctance to go outside.
It's not the one just out of this window here, is it?
Where are you?
At my desk.
Talking about something
That's
over your shoulder.
Yeah.
Why the hell aren't you in there? Every single thing on here says lazy salesman.
The price at the minute is a bit out of my budget.
I mean, what is your... Or is it...
Vern, what is your... Or is it? What is your... Or is it? What is your or is it?
Yeah.
Say the word budget.
Budget.
Say the word money.
Money.
How much money have you got? When do you want to buy? Are you looking to buy today? Have you got a phobia?
No, I just tend to... I can see it on there, but I've always known I waffle more than get to the point, so yeah.
It's a good job that this isn't called Ruth Badger's Motorhomes, because you'd have your P45.
Humiliated, Vern goes to apologise.
Right, straight to the point. Look here, I've just seen that shower of shit.
I'm glad you came in and said that.
Mm.
Because you got it in you.
To be fair.
She's right, it's laziness. She's,
you got to give it.
It's not until it's put before you like that you realise that what should have took 10, 15 minutes was just an hour full of bullshit, so apologies. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. All
right. Thank you very much.
Okay, no worries.
I'm going to fucking shake your hand, man.
Apologies.
Thank you, Dave. Shake your hand. All right.
It's the end of Ruth's second day at Greentrees. And after exposing some fundamental flaws, back at the hotel, she's seeing red.
The one thing that is shocking about Greentrees, the fact that they are so busy and yet they waste so much. I can smell the laziness. I can smell the complacency. I can hear the bullshit come in from just pulling up on the drive from the salespeople. I won't let these problems carry on in Greentrees. I'll smash them out if I need to.
It's the middle of the Badger's first week at Greentrees. With competitors breathing down their neck in a stagnating market, she's determined to save the company from a downward spiral by turning these slackers into slick salesmen.
I've been in the business now for 3 days, and there's certain problems that I've found that I want to highlight and actually put a stop to now. Sales technique. You three, you are lazy salesmen, which is why I will physically drag you out of your seats if I see a customer walk past you and you don't get off your arse and see him. Because today is that line in the sand. Matt, how technical are you? You know everything there is to know about caravans, but you don't sell them, you point.
What do you mean I point?
Right, the fact that you stood in the middle and you went like that, that does that, that does that, that does that, and you took me to a caravan that was $3,000 below my budget.
It was within your budget?
It was $3,000 below my budget. If I've got $12,000 to spend, I would actually go for something that's 12 to 13 and then go, well, this is what you could have.
It was £1,500 under budget.
Yeah, do you know what, Matt? You seem to have an answer for everything.
Yeah, I know.
Matt, I get the feeling you're not even listening to Ruth. The words are going straight over your head. I don't know why, because she's talking sense.
I am listening.
Right, there is a huge, huge problem with teamwork. I want competitive salespeople. Neil, you've got competitive salespeople. It's fantastic. The bad point is they are that competitive, it's unhealthy. And that is affecting the business. So from today, it stops. I'm going to clear the air. I'm going to give you all the opportunity to get all the moans, all the actual problems out, and I'm going to give you a shock pull because you're going to sort them out. The good news for you, Neil, is you have got an exceptional salesman. And that's you, Paul. What upsets me is the fact that you're not training any of them.
I have been a salesman. I'm trying to be a manager. If there's areas I miss, yeah, I'm more than willing to learn.
If these problems aren't sorted out, it will take months to unfold all your good work. I haven't got much time left with you, but I will not walk out of this business until I've started to address these problems. And that literally starts now. Let's get on with it. The biggest surprise at the meeting was Matt. He stood there with such an arrogant stance about him. I mean, the way that he acted in front of me is disrespectful, but to do that in front of the people that actually employ him is unforgivable.
Having highlighted their problems, the Badger starts off by tackling the boys' abysmal sales technique and is taking them back to basics.
So you've spotted them already because you're eyeing them up?
I did wonder what they were for.
What I want you to do is pick a product and sell it to me.
Okay. Very small and compact, so you can keep it in a handbag.
This handbag's obviously leather, black in colour.
Bad luck, I know, to put it up inside, but I'm going to anyways.
It extends.
Is this the sort of handbag you might potentially be interested in?
Well, to be fair, you've told me absolutely nothing about it other than it's black.
This is a new model, this one, so I'm just getting to grips to this one myself.
It's what would be a good incentive for you to buy this handbag?
Is that you, Dunn?
I think so. I'm not keen on umbrella sales, but yeah.
Right.
After everyone's had their turn and without much success, Ruth shows them how it's really done.
How long do you take to get ready when you go out?
15 minutes.
And how long do you take on your hair?
5 minutes.
You'd spend a lot of money on gel?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah, so you care about the way that you look?
Yeah, I do, yeah.
You've spent 20 minutes getting ready. You're going out with a girl of your dreams. You walk out the door, it starts to tip down with rain.
what do you do? Well, the good news is that I've got the solution in my hand, because this umbrella, now what's the first thing I've done different to you there?
You've opened it up.
No, I've sold you the dream. I've established that straight away you've got the need.
Uh-huh.
And then I'm giving you the solution. Okay, you never asked me for the clothes. Right, don't be afraid. You know yesterday when you went, funny, right. You see, I actually think, Vern, that I know the root of your problems, because I think you've got an issue with your self-confidence.
Yeah, you're spot on. Sometimes I feel that I haven't got enough confidence to ask for the deal.
When did you actually acknowledge that your confidence had gone?
When Mark came to sales, as we all know, he'd had a flying start, and it was always Mark this, Mark that, Mark's doing well, Mark's banging the numbers in. I actually thought to myself, I might as well not fucking be here, you know, then they don't actually know I'm here.
The biggest issue with your confidence is you, because you don't believe in yourself. And
you're
if
right.
You don't believe in yourself,
who the hell
is going to believe in you when you're selling?
Yeah, the annoying thing with me is I do understand that. It's just doing something about it as well.
Well, you are, because you're sitting there and you're listening to me, and that's the first step.
Uh-huh.
For you, your issue is the way that you present it.
Sure.
You need to relax. When you smile, the world lights up. I mean that. Your face, everything changes. You need to relax. When you were selling around the caravan, I nearly grabbed your shoulders and went, relax, loosen up, relax. You don't actually demonstrate the product. You said to me, so what do I need to do? What are you looking for? What? Basically, what you're saying is do my job.
You spat on that.
Yeah, you're a smart ass, aren't you?
Sorry.
Do you know what, Matt? You really, really winded me up.
Am I?
You have got such an attitude problem. And the worst thing is... No, oh, really? Are you shocked that I think that?
No. I'm not shocked. I can't get on with everybody. I mean, I don't deliberately wind you up.
You're talking rubbish. It's not about getting on with people. Your attitude comes across in the way you sell.
Well, I don't know. Yeah, I can't say that everybody feels the same as you.
I actually think that Matt thinks I'm pitting a one-woman war against him, which I'm not. You know, I'm not the only person in this business that feels like that, so I'm going to get him together with Neil and we're going to sort this out once and for all. We didn't actually get off to the best start, Matt, because anybody who wants to walk in and brag that they're late doesn't fit very well with me. You don't listen to anything I say. I really honestly think I'm not even going to go into your ability because your attitude absolutely stinks.
It's kind of... fucking buck up or get out, because I'm not going to fucking tolerate it. I don't know why you've got this attitude. Well, I really don't know.
I don't know.
Well,
I can't explain
Matt,
it. Yeah, well, maybe I have, but I don't know I've got it, because I can't see myself.
You know exactly what's going on, Matt. You're not fucking stupid.
No,
I know that. And so I think the best way for us all to go forward is go away tonight, you come back in the morning, make a decision. Are you in or are you out?
Tomorrow is D-Day for Matt. It's when he makes the decision of whether he wants to work in this company and work on his attitude or leave and go. And God help him if he does go, because realistically, he ain't going to get very far in life with the attitude that he's got.
The next morning, a sheepish Matt arrives in good time.
Good morning. How are we?
I'm watching the condemned man walk to work.
Morning.
9 o'clock. Good. You know how we left it last night?
Yes. Yeah.
This should be easy. What's it going to be?
Obviously, I appreciate that Ruth is here to help me. She can teach me a lot of things, which I'm prepared to learn. I wish to embrace Ruth a bit more, a lot more than I have done.
Well, I want an absolute assurance from you. This is not talk is cheap.
Mm.
You're either in or you're fucking
I'm
out.
In. I'm in. It's similar. Yeah. At the end of the day, I like working here. And if I have to change to adapt to fit into the environment, then I have to do that.
I don't want to see you slip back. I want to see you actually improve.
Well, yeah, of course, it's in my interest. It makes me more money.
Nice one. All right.
Get on with it.
Lovely job. Cheers, mate. Let you get on.
I could see a physical change in his body language.
Hmm.
Because instead of being like that and all like that, he's actually,
if you flick the switch in him, he's got so much guts and determination, and he really will go out to prove that he can do this better than we think he can.
I am a difficult employee. I don't conform to formulas. I do my own thing, I'm a bit set in my ways, I'm headstrong and I know what I want to do.
It's the end of Ruth's first week at Greentrees, but before she leaves, she wants to tackle Vern and Mark's bitter rivalry that's crippling the sales team.
Right, Paul, this is called the caravan, or motorhome of love.
Okay.
Now, there's a huge politics issue in there. Yes. That's bubbling away. How often do you spend time one-to-one with them?
Not a great deal.
Okay, that's why you've got politics. And I actually want you to get it out of them, most importantly, so that you can actually solve the problems and get them to start working as a team, okay?
Okay.
Vern's called in first, and he wastes no time in airing his grievances about Mark.
He does think he's the sales manager.
He's, to be fair, noticing the things that probably I should be noticing. Things like getting vans ready for the yard and stuff like that. I think you have issues with a lot of that stuff. But very often, before he comes to me, he'll come to you and tell you to do it.
Mark comes to me and...
tells you? Yeah, no.
Exactly.
And that's what Mark does wrong.
Mark tells me.
Yes, he does.
And I sit there and I think, and this is honest, I sit there and think, you're on the same level as me, pal. You don't fucking tell me anything. We'll work together, but you don't tell me anything.
Okay,
and
well, that's...
That's how it's been. Yeah, he does tell me.
That's an issue for Mark and for me to discuss with Mark.
Yeah.
Hello, Mark.
Hello.
Next up is Mark, who's equally happy to dish the dirt.
The biggest way which I think will help me is you.
Yeah.
Because if I didn't have to sit there and bollock them every time I found a part exchange sitting around a yard that hadn't been done and not one on the internet and the yard looks shit, then it wouldn't be me who they think that about. They'd think that about you instead.
Where do you think you have the position to bollock them for not putting a motorhome in the yard?
Because it's detrimental to the company.
Do you think sometimes the way you go about things causes you... some of your issues?
Yeah, for sure. In the past, it definitely has.
The problem with you, and this is where Paul is actually saying it, but you need to listen, is the fact that it's all in the way you ask.
Okay.
You have the potential to be a team leader, but the faults that you've actually got in your sales are the faults that you'll have in your management, which is really interesting, because it's all about the first bit, which is the rapport.
It will be a lot of effort for me to completely change how I deal with people and stuff, and that's fine, and I can do that.
Ruth's first week is at an end, but before she leaves, she gets Paul and the salesman together for one final pep talk.
Right, now I know you're going away to an exhibition next week. I'm going to set you a challenge while you're away. The person who sells the most at the exhibition gets a surprise present when you return. So what you need to do is put into practice everything that I've shown you this week and let's really see who can sell. But it's time for me to go. And now hold the tears back.
Yeah.
Hold the tears back. I'm leaving Norfolk. I'll see you all soon.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
What a week that has been. I've had everything thrown at me, from politics to bad attitude to confidence issues, lack of management, and most importantly, lazy and complacent salesmen. So I'm intrigued to see what happens when I return. And I pray to God that they do not start to slip back to the way they were.
Coming up, morale takes a knock when the boys go it alone.
It's been a lot quieter than what we expected and what we hoped for.
I'll be happy to get the end this week on 5.
It's anyone's game in the final sales competition.
Are you happy to go ahead with that?
Is it likely that you'd do a deal today?
And Matt makes an early departure.
He's avoided me at all costs today. It's bullshit.
Sales guru Ruth Badger has spent the last week in Norfolk with troubled caravan and motorhome dealership Greentrees. But with part exchange and used vehicles accounting for the majority of sales, profit margins are tight and high volume selling is paramount.
The Senator has the onboard water tank.
So far, she's tackled bad attitude.
You spat on that.
Yeah, you're a smart ass, aren't you?
And equipped the lazy salesman with vital selling skills.
Now, what's the first thing I've done different to you there?
You've opened it up.
No, I've sold you the dream.
But for the next week, they'll have to go it alone. It's Greentrees' first day without Ruth, And with the three salesmen away at a major trade show, it's the perfect opportunity to put their new skills into practice.
Right, let's go and have a look, see if we can talk anyone into buying a caravan.
Motivated by the promise of a prize from Ruth for the top seller, things get off to a good start. Instead of waiting for customers to approach them, all three boys make that crucial first move.
Can I help at all? Can we be of any assistance today?
Can I give you any assistance on this very fine day?
Do you need help there, sir?
They're also acting on the Badger's advice. Mark's working on his rapport skills.
Have you been given the price for it? Would you like a better one?
I have changed techniques, tried to be a bit more relaxed with the customers and smile at them a bit more.
How old are your grandchildren?
4 and 2 at the moment.
So right, okay. Well, you have obviously got your partition door here, which is obviously handy for when you go to sleep.
We're pleased you grabbed us. We are impressed with that.
Your eyes are something that you may not see.
Impressed with that.
And sales phobic Vern is showing improvement when it comes to closing the deal.
I'm not scaremongering, but the availability is going back every day.
More than likely we'll come back. We won't be grabbed by anyone else, it'll be you.
Thank you very much. Things are starting to happen. I feel a lot more confident than I have done before. I haven't actually sold it to the lady and gentleman yet, but I've got a very positive vibe on it.
Matt's also trying hard not to be overly technical.
Yeah, normally after I'd explain the caravan and how it works and how the functions work. To be fair, in your case, you've already got one.
But despite them benefiting from Ruth's advice, as the week goes on, there's fewer customers and competition with fellow dealers gets harder.
Well, as you can see, the attendance is pretty low. It's been a lot quieter than what we expected and what we hoped for.
By the last day, with sales figures down, everyone's feeling demoralised.
What did you want for the week?
20 plus.
Yeah. How many are you on now?
Still 7.
Just on 7. What did you say you're on?
3 motorhomes and a caravan.
So you're on 4 and I'm on 2, so I'll be happy to get the end this week on 5, to be honest.
With the boys' spirits at a low, the Badger's return couldn't come sooner.
I really do hope that the positive impact I had while I was there has continued. The squabbling has not come back. But for me, I'm interested to see if a certain individual has improved his attitude.
As soon as Ruth arrives, she calls a progress meeting with the salesman and Paul.
Before I went away, I set you a competition. So, what were the scores on the doors? Vern, how many did you sell?
I only sold 5 this time.
There's no such word as only. Stop underselling yourself. You sold 5.
I sold 5.
Congratulations. So actually, Ruth, I sold 5 in a real cutthroat environment. And as a dealership, we did really well. Mm-hmm. That's how you say it back to me. Matt, how did you do?
I sold 6.
You sold 6. Beat your brother then. Mark?
I sold 11 in person and 2 over the phone.
So you actually sold 13 in the end?
Yes.
Bloody hell, that's massive.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
£150.
Thank you.
I only sold 5 caravans. No, fucking hell, I sold 5 caravans. You know, when there were no people around, Ruth, that's what he should have been saying. So there's a lot of work to be done, still with Vern.
The Badger may be fully aware of the salesman's needs, but she's eager to see if Paul's upped his game.
Have you actually done any training with them?
Once this week's out of the way with paperwork and getting stuff caught up, we then can knuckle down and get some training going on. But yes, I've been trying to get closer to them, spend more time with them. I now have systems in place where I can keep a closer eye on what they're doing on a day-to-day basis.
Which are? Dispatches.
We have a chart here behind the door.
You got your sales board?
Yes, so I can tell exactly where the guys are as far as their sales and what they've done this month, what they've done last month, where they are at any given time. And it's a real-time board. They update it as they go along.
Well done for that, though, because that really makes sure that you've got your finger on the pulse.
Yeah.
The next day, and with time running out, it's the Badger's last chance to whip the boys into shape. She arrives with a plan on how to culminate all the hard work.
There's £300 cash up for stakes. Whoever sells the most will get the £300 cash. So who thinks they're going to win?
Yeah, I do. Definitely.
Oh, a bit of confidence from Vern there.
Definitely.
That makes change. Right, well, there's no good standing there because you've only got one day to do this. Off you go.
The sales competition has brought a new burst of energy, and straight away Matt and Vern head out to the yard.
They seek them here, they seek them there. Where are you, you buggers?
But clinical Mark is taking a more cunning approach.
Just seeing if there's anyone else I spoke to in the last few weeks who I might be able to get a deal out of.
Matt's found a customer, but unluckily for him, they're just browsing.
Not looking to buy today, unfortunately. It's going to be a few months due to a house sale.
One thing I'd say is, if your customers out here aren't interested and they're just looking, get back in and see who's coming in and out of the shop.
Morning. How are you doing?
Yeah, good, thanks.
Help at all, are you? I'm just
got some bags.
There's somebody walking through the door now.
Oh, look out! Customers! Go, go, go!
Can I help you with anything at all?
Oh no, just a technician.
Give me a while, I'll pop back and see you. See if I can help you with it. All right.
What did you say to that couple?
I asked them if I could point them in the right direction.
No. Right, stop. What you do is you say, not a problem, I'll tell you what, I'll take you to exactly where the used caravans are.
We found the right vehicle.
While Vern and Matt are on red alert, Mark's convinced his hot lead to come in.
Ration figures together.
After Ruth's pep talk, instead of selling through the window, Vern is taking customers out to the yard and demonstrating the benefits.
But that's ideal, it's just there. Nice and easily accessible.
As things start to pick up for Vern and Mark, Matt's yet to entice any customers.
I'm not concerned. If I don't win the competition, I'm not going to lose any sleep over it.
And the new Vern, rather than avoiding the subject of money, confidently leads the conversation.
Is it likely that you'd do a deal today on that?
Well, give us a little while to think about it. We're here for a week.
Several hours into the competition, with Mark and Vern making good progress and customers starting to pour in, Ruth spotted someone missing.
The place is on fire, it's busy, but I can't see Matt for love of the money.
You're only at Sandringham, you said, didn't you?
After spending over half an hour with the customers, Vern clinches his first deal and bags a sale worth £17,000.
Good deal. Fantastic. Here's some paper. Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you. Is there any way that before I got my mitts on you, you would have worked that hard at that sale?
They would have probably left here about an hour and a half ago.
But as soon as he goes one up, Mark's hot lead reaches boiling point.
Yeah, if you can get it for 4.25, then where do I sign?
After lunch, having disappeared for over an hour, the reason for Matt's absence becomes clear.
I've just bitten into a sandwich and cracked my rear molar, and now my whole side of my face is throbbing.
You alright, Matt?
Yeah, well, it was. Unfortunately, I've got a bit of dental problems at the minute, and I'm in a lot of pain. So I've just called the dentist and I'm trying to get an emergency appointment. The whole side of my face is now throbbing and it's extremely painful.
Matt told me he's going to leave because he's got toughache. It's bullshit. I actually think he's leaving because he's made no sales. He's avoided me at all costs today because he's actually shying away from the competition.
Do you think Matthew left because he was losing?
Yes.
No, not at all.
With one man down and Mark and Vern level pegging, in the last few hours there's everything to play for.
And if the mains goes in there.
Mark and Vern have both got another two in front of them that potentially they could close today.
And it's not long before Vern creeps ahead and clinches his second deal.
Thank you very much for that. That's me on the way. You're such a
big star to me. But the competition couldn't be closer when Mark makes it 2-2.
Are you happy to go ahead with that?
Yeah, definitely.
Lovely. Thank you very much for your business.
Thank you.
Minutes later, Ruth calls time. At the end of the day, between them, the boys have secured sales worth over a staggering £55,000.
How many did you actually sell, Vern?
Two.
Very well done. And Mark?
Also two.
Which just shows you what talent that you've got in the business, Paul and Neil.
With a tie for the top salesman, the Badger dishes out £300 each.
Well done.
Thanks so much.
Well done, mate.
And what you've actually got there is a demonstration of teamwork. When I come into the business, you were that aggressive instead of being competitive that it was unhealthy. Now, you're acknowledging each other as a team and being competitive, so all that's going to do is drive both of you forwards.
The competition has been a huge success, and Ruth will be back in a month to make sure they've kept up the hard work.
We're not at the end by a long way. We've got a lot of work to do, but what I can now see is the team that I want to work hard now beginning to understand far better where I'm coming from.
Somebody like Ruth coming in who's got a proven record cannot really fail, as long as you listen, and I've been prepared to listen, and things have really improved. And we've got years. These are going to improve a lot more yet, but we're definitely on the right road.
After leaving them on such a high, 4 weeks later, the Badger is returning to Norfolk to see if they've kept up the hard work. First on her port of call is MD Neil.
How has business been since I've walked through those front doors?
If you're talking numbers, we're 20% up, which is fantastic. But that ain't the cherry on the cake for me. The biggest thing that I've been pleased with is we are so much more professional. You've made us into a truly professional company, which is fantastic. Thank you.
With business booming and the boss on cloud nine, Ruth is keen to find out if the salesmen are as equally triumphant.
How have your sales been going since I've gone?
My sales have been going really well. I've been away, but I've done very well since I've been back. I've done 5 deals on Saturday.
5 deals in one day?
Yeah, 5 deals in one day.
My God. Did you sit down during any of your sales?
I don't think I sat down at all.
No. No. Did you smile and build rapport?
Yeah, I've done a lot of smiling, especially when I got to the 5th one.
Former Mr. Clinical Mark is obviously reaping the rewards. But next, Ruth seeks out Vern to see if his confidence has come back for good.
Yeah, how many are you doing?
Well, this month I've up to 15 now.
15?
15.
Are you beating every single person in that sales department?
Yeah, at the minute, yeah, I am, yeah.
You're the top salesman,
Vern? I know, it's good, isn't it? Yeah.
Good, I'll be doing cartwheels.
Oh, I've done those already. That's my hand.
So what's changed?
Everything's changed from the minute I get in. Straight away I'm looking for the first customer and thinking, where can I get my next deal from?
Well, I am not only pleased but very proud of you.
Bless you. Good on you.
You are a star.
We're a team. Can you marry me?
No.
No, go on.
With Vern topping the sales board and Mark close behind, the Badger wants to know if the positivity has rubbed off on Matt.
How are your sales figures this month?
I'm up to 6.
6?
Yeah, it's not good.
So in regards to the tips that I actually taught you while I was here, have you put those into practice?
Yeah, I have been using some of them. Talking more about what you could potentially do with the caravan as opposed to what the caravan's made of.
How's the attitude doing?
I hope it's changed, I hope it's for the better, and I hope I get on better.
Could you actually see how that was affecting your sales?
I couldn't at the time, because obviously I was too close to it, but maybe I can a bit now, yeah.
That's good.
With even Matt showing signs of improvement, the Badger's optimistic about Greentree's future.
I haven't in the last 3 years worked with any business that has left me feeling so rewarded, and I'm absolutely gobsmacked how quickly you've all turned it around. For me, that is a fantastic achievement.
We really have enjoyed you being here, and it's been more than just a learning curve for us. So we'd like to give you something back again.
Aww, thank you very much. And you got your kiss about that? So, I'd like to raise 2 toasts. The first one is to Vern. The fact that when I come, your confidence was so low. And actually, you're kicking ass this month when it comes to the sales. So, well done, Vern. And finally, while you've got your glasses there, to Greentrees, because my God, what a hell of a company you are. Congratulations. Cheers. When I walked into the company, it was full of lazy and complacent salesmen. There was one hell of an atmosphere, and my God, haven't they turned the corner. Not only have they increased their sales by 20% since I walked through those doors, but every single one of them have improved. For me, that is the best situation in there, and they can only continue to thrive on it.